Hi, I'm Rich Ahrens. Welcome to this experiment in fun, silliness, and creative thought. What follows is the first session of the Art of the Short Cartoon class. In this session, I introduce the students to several original story character concepts of my own. I pitch them the basic premise of what each cartoon is all about, giving them the option to choose one concept to develop in this class session. Once a consensus is made amongst the students, we proceed to come up with a story based upon the concept chosen. If the concept changes and improves, that's all for the better. Characters are created, added, dropped as needed. Plots altered, dropped, and newly inspired are all welcome, as long as they're getting better in the process. By the end of the session, we should have a pretty good idea of what the story and characters in the cartoon will be like. Or will we? In later videos, you'll see how the cartoon takes shape in the following week through character development, dialogue writing, and some surprise twists. So let's begin. We start with some short personal introductions from each of our students.
This is the Art of the Short Cartoon class. This is where we're going to come up with a story, gag it up. I want to introduce the people that really want to do great short cartoons and continue the tradition of basically inventing the great classic cartoons to come. So we're just going to go around the room, the virtual room, and have everybody introduce who they are and what they want to do, what they're really interested in. And they're all artists. They're all artist writers who are going to create the great classic cartoons of today and tomorrow. So let's go around. Let's first go to Richard Smith.
I'm Richard, and I'm an artist. I've been animating for a while now. I graduated from FIT in 2019. Right now, I'm looking for jobs, and there's actually a lot of things I want to do with my stuff. I want to make cartoons and maybe a web comic or maybe a YouTube docuseries, but mostly I'd want to make cartoons, but good cartoons. Maybe even establish an old little indie studio, if I had the money, that is.
That would help. All right, let's go to Jillian.
Hi, I'm Jillian, and I just really like writing stories, and I want to be an animator one day. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm hoping to make something really great. Something that people remember, I guess.
All right, let's go to Natalie.
So hello, everyone. I'm Natalie Palumbo. I'm a trained motion graphics designer and visual effects compositor based in the New York metro area. And the reason that I wanted to take this course is I feel that the art of storyboarding is expansive and elaborate. And there are many different applications to the process, especially for the art of the short cartoon. And I was fascinated by the study of it, and I wanted to know more about it.
Terrific. All right, Rhiannon.
Hi, I'm Rhiannon. I'm an aspiring concept artist and decided to take this class because I am also interested in storyboarding and hope to perhaps make my own cartoons one day.
Terrific. All right, let's go to Luke.
My name is Luke Ski, and I am a storyboard artist, writer, and voice actor. I worked at Cartoon Network for 3 years on the TV show Mighty Magiswords for the whole run of that series, which was an awesome time. And I basically just want to continue my career, writing and storyboarding, and when I can, voicing, awesome, funny cartoons for TV or for whatever.
Hi there. My name is Brandy Kjærsgaard, and I am the owner and creator of Brandy Beast, which is a brand new company that makes monsters, creatures, beasts, you name it. I enjoy the challenge. Right now it's primarily masks, but I'm hoping to expand into costumes and other things as well. I have been interested in art for as long as I can remember. It is a huge passion of mine. Ever since I was a kid, it was archaeologist or Disney animator. That's what I wanted to be. I was interested in taking this class because I want to hone my skills and keep getting better as a storyteller.
All right, so here we go.
I have this character called Frankenfud, and I have a couple of stories for him. He's kind of a Frankenstein guy, but he has like a laser built in his head. And I have some theories on who may have built him. We don't know exactly who built him and then put him in the world. So I'm just thinking something sort of like Frankenfud, 10 foot tall and brains of mud. He's Frankenfud, fist of fury, but brains of dud. Frankenfud. He's got a big laser out of his HUD. Frankenfud. He'd be going around blasting butts. Frankenfud. You know, it's not a very sophisticated song, but you get the idea. He's got a big fist, just like Atomic Thud. Frankenfud. You can imagine the visuals that would be going with this. Be very fast, very kind of silly, stupid stuff. He's got bigger thighs than Nona Judd. Vampires come to suck your blood. Frankie comes in, name of good. Frank is good guy, but he's big stupid kind of dude. You get the idea. He's like smashing vampires and stuff like that.
All right, the Little Devils, kind of evil little twin girls. You know, they're very cute, but they're nasty. They do bad things. And there was another version of them I had. You can see down here, there was the, I had this idea of the Attack of the Non-Photo Blue Devils. It was just another variant on the same idea. Both of these ideas up here to see which one sort of appealed more to you guys. I don't know, non-photo blue, that may be something you guys don't know about. It used to be non-photo blue. You could draw non-photo blue and then you wouldn't see it. You could rough things in and then you could go over in black pencil. Natalie knows.
Sounds familiar?
You are familiar with that. Okay. You know, because I don't know, sometimes it's, you know, if you're born later in the digital era, it didn't matter anymore. It's Halloween. Frank is going to babysit the little devils for his neighbor, Axarella. She must leave her castle tonight to go out trick-or-beating or trick-or-treating with her girlfriend, Draculella, and has no one to watch over the kids, the little devils. And that's Schmen and Drick, who do things to Frank that should have sent him to his maker, literally. Now, Schmen and Drick, it's a little bit of a Jewish joke, but my father, who just passed recently. Schmendrick, I don't know if anybody here is Jewish. I don't think any of you are. But Schmendrick, it was my dad's favorite, probably my dad's favorite Jewish word. And it was kind of anything that was Germanic or Yiddish, my dad would have a lot of fun with those words. And Schmendrick meant, Schmendrick was, I don't know if everybody's heard the word schmuck, but Schmendrick was another word for schmuck. It was kind of like an idiot. And he used that word a lot when I was a kid. And you know, those things end up sticking somehow in American language. So it may actually be a fun thing to use. But if somebody has a better name for the two little devils, that might be, I just never named them until this morning. I just thought, you know, that could be fun just to call them Schmen and Drick. I don't know, to me it's funny. So they do some things to Frank that, you know, should send him to his maker. They tie him to a giant spider web to have him torn apart, but he just gets tickled as his body parts are shredded apart. You know, so maybe we could have some fun with that. His body parts going all over, but he thinks it's hilarious. Then they dunk him in some acid and they dissolve him to a skeleton, or maybe they dissolve him to bits. But the acid vaporizes back into like a soupy version of himself. It's just like all over the floor. And he's like laughing about it. He says, oh, you know, you know, he actually like, maybe he crawls off as, you know, a flattened version. He says, oh, I better get back to the gym. I'll be better later, girls. You know, so that could, it could be just a blackout, you know, gag like that. And then they bake him a cake, but with carnivorous chocolate termites. You know, they fill it up. You know, they're gonna fill it up. And that, you know, it was a great cake. He eats it up. Cut to the inside of him. And they like just start eating him alive inside. And we cut to the outside and it looks like a machine gun is like bullets just tear him to pieces, cut close to the ants, and they're like have big bellies, like they just ate him. You know, he's gone. You know, that was a good meal. Then all of a sudden they start shaking, like, oh, this isn't good. And then they explode, clears, and you just see Frank sitting there. He's like sort of reassembled from what happened. And he's just, you just can't destroy Frank. He's indestructible. You know, the stupid idiot cannot be destroyed. It's going with that kind of thing. Maybe it's the big ending, this Gorilla Gator thing. I've had that for about 7 years and I want to use that character. I'm not married to anything. I'm just throwing, there's a lot. I just want to tell you, you guys can't see it. Well, I have gags going back to high school around here, and I've got lots of characters, so I have buckets of things. And I just, anyway, the little devils decide to run away from home because it's getting towards midnight. They want to get out of there before the mom gets back from trick-or-treating. To escape Frank, their pet Gorilla Gator in the moat is dying and needs mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. So Frank goes over to the edge of the water, right? He's trying to find the gator. But the gator comes up, it's huge, and just like bites him and takes him away. You know, Frank's kicking, you know, you see his feet kicking out of its mouth. It drags him under. Gator just pulverizes, you know, eats him. Little devils are laughing. And they run away. They're trying to get out of it. They have to go back into the house somehow. And by the time they get to the front door, there's a giant alligator purse sitting there. And you can see the face of the Gorilla Gator. You know, and Frank's just there leaning against the purse. But all of a sudden, Axarella comes home at the stroke of midnight. She's furious. Says, why aren't these kids in bed? You know, what the hell's going on, Frank? So the kids get smart. All of a sudden, they cover for him. And they say, well, look, Uncle Frank, he made a big purse with us. He was so good. We love him. They cuddle with him and everything. So they make everything all right. They give him a big hug and a kiss. And it's the ending. Everything's fine. And we are ourselves. So it's a happy ending. The Halloweenies. Okay. These are like little Halloweenies. They're made of radioactive dried up hot dog parts that have been genetically reconstructed by a mad Beverly Hills plastic surgeon's extra body parts played by George Gloomy. Okay. This is Halloween. They intend to steal all the candy on Earth as the kids arrive at each door, trick-or-treating. Frank's mission is stopping their rocket from leaving the Earth with all the goodies. So that's the setup. We show some montage of them stealing all their goodies and taking them to some cave or something, or volcano, you know, like James Bond kind of thing. They have a volcano, they got a big rocket, and they're going to take all the candy to some planet somewhere. They're just bad little creeps that do that kind of thing. So Frank, he has to stop the rocket from taking off. So we do a series of blackout gags. Frank is outsmarted by a particularly foul Halloweeny named Holy, who manages to do horrific things to Frank, but somehow just can't kill the irrepressible schmuck of a hero. In the end, he shoots down the rocket with his laser brain. So I'm thinking Frank keeps trying to, you know, knock down the rocket, or he keeps trying to sneak in, and he keeps getting destroyed by this little creeping dude. And that's where you guys come in, where we would come up with ways of Frank getting pulverized completely and just can't get past this little dude. I'm thinking rocket's in flight. Frank is tied to the rocket, does actually, you know, explode the rocket, and all the candy goes to the kids on Earth. Until the end, he is getting butt kicked. Which cartoon do you guys feel you would want to work on?
I want to work on the Halloweenies.
The Halloweenies.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go around the room. We can vote on it.
I'm actually quite fascinated by the non-photo Blue Devils. There could be an entire exploration of those characters in the idea of maybe people know they exist, know they're out there, have seen them, but when you go to take a picture of them, they don't show up. So that's something that I was thinking about.
Uh-huh.
So it'd be a clever little in-joke for anyone involved in traditional animation, but it could also have a mysterious component to it and be comical at the same time.
They could be causing all the problems in the world. You know, I don't know, you know, maybe there's something to that. If they're causing some sort of mischief, if we come up with a plot that works for them.
Actually, off of that thought that Natalie just had, you could have some really fun slapstick humor or like bad date humor. I would love to see a couple where like the guy's trying to get close to a girl and like the drink spills over. It's actually the non-photo Blue Devils knocking things over and stuff. But because like she said, you kind of can't see them. I don't know if it's only in a photo. That's where, you know, maybe they're taking a selfie or something and we're kind of going with the current times. But it would be fun if they kind of had some kind of knockover slapsticky, you know, this is why the guy gets slapped kind of joke. It's not his fault. It's actually these guys. That's actually really interesting to me.
Say, you know, something with the Blue Devils is good, like they're there, but when you try to get photo evidence of them, you can't see them and they'll think you're cuckoo.
Maybe it's the non-photo Blue Devils through history. They were behind World War One. Like, you know, like the Hindenburg, we cut to the Hindenburg and it's like, why did it, you know, blow up? Well, you know, we go, you know, we cut to the, you know, inside pilot is in there and, you know, he knocks something, something gets knocked over, or different, you know, different disasters in history. Why did they happen? You know, I don't know.
You could have like a detective trying to chase him down or whatever. And they just keep ruining this poor guy's life.
Or maybe some like,
like a paranormal investigator or something.
Yeah. Like that.
Yeah.
You can get it down to something simple where it's a,
or some conspiracy theorist. Like he somehow knows about them.
Yeah, you could have like a whole montage with like, I don't know, like ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs and they're drawn onto those. And he's like, I know these exist because they've been spotted throughout
like,
history.
Has, like, drawings. And like this like string board on the wall.
Yeah.
And everything points to these two.
Mm-hmm.
You think it's an archaeologist who's trying to figure it out, or it's a it's like an Indiana Jones kind of a guy?
Yeah, some kind of conspiracy nut.
Maybe it's something like that. He finds him in a hieroglyphics thing. He finds him in the Declaration of Independence. You know, it's
well,
like
how, maybe he's made, how this guy is making this telling about these devils to like some historical society. He's laughed at and kicked out, and I'll say, I'll prove it to you.
Right.
Oh yeah, and I think Natalie was talking about like spilling over a drink, and the girl's like, what the heck? And maybe he has like an ex-wife or something, and the, like his chase for the devil just kind of tore him apart and everything, and he keeps trying to get back together with her or something.
But then he notices all these strange things starting to happen in the area, and he's like, they're here.
Yeah, well, like a spidey sense, but for those two specifically.
Well, I think it's good if it also destroyed his marriage. So it's like he does.
He's at a bar or something, and he's like, she'll take me back once I
find it's like a sunk cost fallacy. He has to get them because he keeps failing, and it's like, this is what's going to solve all his problems.
That's only a good open. Like, he tells the bartender about him. The bartender thinks he's cuckoo, but then these strange things start happening in the bar, and he knows who's responsible for it, and then the chase begins.
It should be a personal thing. So it's like, it ruined his marriage, finds them on hieroglyphics. you know, maybe he does find them in, you know, different historical incident, you know, and it's only in certain pictures that they show up, right? It's the, you know, maybe it's in the portrait.
That could easily be dismissed as legend.
Maybe it's in the portrait of George Washington, but it's, you can't only see it. I don't know. You know?
Yeah, because they're non-photo blue. They don't show up in any like electronic photographs, but there's like paintings and carvings and, you know, any man-made, handmade thing that can record what they look like exists, but nobody can photograph them.
I mean, like, what's the first, maybe it's only in the, it's like the first photograph or it's in the,
what if it's a cave drawing?
The cave drawings, yes, yes.
Right, the bison, the thing with the bison, you know, and there's like those two little guys are there, right? And
he's a cave drawing.
He puts on the special glasses. Or
yeah,
something.
made of blue dust.
Yeah, the special... and he sees them there.
The drawing is of them kicking over Stonehenge like dominoes.
And he's trying to prove it to
everyone else.
The world.
Trying to prove it to the world, but he cannot do it somehow.
Like I said, for exposition, he tells the bartender about his travels and his research, but then strange things start happening.
Every time he does get the evidence, the two little ones steal it or get it away from him or something.
Maybe the whole thing could be a flashback, as he's telling the bartender, but then we see him trying to catch the little guys and being foiled at every turn.
What if, at the very start, and that's how I finally caught them, and then every episode is a flashback about how he didn't catch them, and at the end you're like, how did he catch them? And you're trying to wonder more, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, how is it I never caught them? The bartender takes off a mask and he was one of them. I don't know. do the reveal, you know.
And the cycle continues.
You know, the guy just leaves the bar and then they show up cleaning the glass next to the bartender, you know, or something. You know, I don't know. The bartender doesn't even notice. And he says, yeah, let's just close up, you guys. And they're like, okay.
You know, whatever you say, boss.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. Those guys always have to have a Bronx accent, you know. No matter where they came from in history.
Could be from New Jersey.
It doesn't really matter.
It's like a pretty good place for chaos to originate from.
Right.
But everybody from New Jersey came over from New York.
And one of them could be like a little slurred in speech, like, you know.
Yeah, and the hiccup. Somehow he put on these funny glasses and he was in the Metropolitan Museum of Art and he saw these things in the Mona Lisa.
Through the Last Supper or something?
Yeah.
He started seeing them in the painting and then he found them in the hieroglyphics. He went to Egypt, wrote his papers on it.
And it got him laughed at by the scientific community.
Right, it ruined his... He could be an Indiana Jones kind of guy, I guess. Traveled the world chasing them.
That could actually be a really fun angle too. If you kind of just do like the spoof fail of Indiana Jones. I know it goes a little bit off of the train we were just saying, but like, you know, the guy swings across the chasm on a rope and they're cutting the rope so he falls in, or the giant boulder that's coming after you and they have a ditch dug out so, you know, he trips and falls or whatever. Like, it might actually be a really fun thing too, to take gags that we all know and love and everybody's seen those movies. But if you have these guys responsible for why they didn't work, the hero isn't the hero. He's a schmuck because of these guys. Yeah. And then you can throw in the fantastical glasses or something or a potion or whatever, a scroll, whatever he needs to see them, because it kind of goes off of that Indiana Jones voodoo, weird, magic-y. We don't have to explain it as solid.
Well, the fact that he's trying to prove they exist gives them motivation to get rid of him.
Exactly.
So it does, because they figure out that we have the moment where they realize, oh, he's trying to prove, you know, because they're like little gremlins, and they realize, oh, we don't want him to tell the world about us, because we
want to keep having fun.
Yeah,
maybe he's actually kind of running for his life.
I mean, he's got guts. I mean, he's going after them, so you know, and they don't want him to expose them, you know, because they like blowing up the Hindenburg, you know, they like you know, ending the pyramids or whatever they did. You know, I mean, yeah, they liked closing you know, yeah, right, destroying the shorts department at Warner Brothers.
They caused the leaning of the Tower of Pisa.
Yeah, right. We actually show them, like, there was like a cornerstone or something, and we see them, like, you know, they've got a couple of hammers and they like you see the tower go you know, and you know, right? I mean, okay, so we could have the Tower of Pisa. We should just make a note, okay? Maybe we'll make a note of the Tower of Pisa.
Any like assassinations in there?
JFK.
Yeah, JFK.
The Last Supper idea.
Yes. Supper.
I don't know if we should do religion.
Yeah, religion is a bit of a...
We could do World War One.
Yeah, or just do Ferdinand.
What was it that kind of human race that kind of went extinct? Was it the Neanderthals?
How about the Northridge Quake?
Right, Northridge Quake.
Okay, like any like major floods?
Let's just say Noah's Flood.
We could do something like Chernobyl. Like they hit...
Oh, oh goodness.
How dark do we want this to get? How, like... This
I'm not saying it's all, I'm just saying they put the reactor off.
Just put it down, because it might spark something else.
For the reason the Cubs won the World Series.
There you go.
Oh, that's good.
They knocked the nose off the Sphinx.
Nose off the Sphinx. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
That's
good. Julius Caesar getting stabbed.
Going back to the nose on the Sphinx bitten? Idea. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
You could apply the same idea to like the Greek and Roman statues where the limbs mm-hmm. are missing.
Well, they're responsible for the Black Plague.
Venus de Milo. Yeah.
Because they both needed back scratchers just to.
Well, it was the Poseidon Adventure, but that was fake.
The Titanic.
They definitely caused the Titanic.
They were just whispering to that dude, just like, not full screen, full steam ahead. They're just like, keep going.
Well, it could have been the extinction of the dinosaurs. I don't know how they caused that.
Earthquakes. Or they sunk Atlantis.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
Atlantis sinking. Oh, that'd be great.
I mean, you know, it's only a 6-minute cartoon, but we can.
They got busy.
We'll pick out the best, you know, our three or four best moments of
of destruction.
Well, they're responsible for the smog in LA.
You could somehow show them. I don't know, like starting like some secret like lizard people council or something. I don't know.
They got Michael Bay hired to make the Transformers movies.
Maybe they were the ones giving Ed Wood advice on the movies that he was producing. Plan 9 from Outer Space.
Space Jam 2. Right. What were you saying, Brandy?
I actually had a question for you guys too, because we have some really good events now.
Yeah.
I'm kind of curious what the personalities might be like. Like if they're really vindictive and evil and malicious, or if they're playful and just highly destructive. Because there's a couple of these.
Playful and highly destructive is good. We want them to be appealing.
Right. Because that Tower of Pisa, the Sphinx Nose, Stonehenge, and Venus, they all kind of have like, you can write games into the actual destruction, like the literally, I got your nose. Like it's really low hanging fruit. But if we do things like that, I think it can really ground us and we can do huge personality off of that.
Yeah, they're what my dad calls ball busters. Like everything's a game to them.
I think maybe you could have one of each. One has more like darker humor tendencies and doing like more evil stuff, and the other one's kind of more playful. Like you could have like a younger and older sibling relationship kind of too.
I think that could work.
I'm kind of picturing like one of the, you know, if one's going to be the Jersey kind of voice devil, maybe the other one could be kind of like a Midwest blue collar, like foreman on a job site. It's kind of like, oh, you see there, the problem with the Stonehenge is it's not round enough. You got to get out your protractor. You got to lay out the angles like this. And, you're going to knock that thing over there. Be careful, buddy.
Some of these things, I mean, Hindenburg is an engineering problem. Chernobyl is definitely an engineering problem. Maybe we don't want to do the atomic thing. I mean, what is their point? Like, what are they up to?
Actually, here's a question for you guys, too. If they don't show up in photos, and some of these events could be, like, really extreme photo bombs, like... Hey, I don't show up in the picture, so I'm going to knock the nose off of this thing. They'll see that. Like, it's a really extreme gesture of showing up in a photo.
They can say, like, real glass, like that photo of VJ Day.
Maybe somehow they can't be seen because they're not humans, but they're trying to make a name for themselves by destroying all these things, and they're hoping that somehow someone's going to find them and be able to, like, show off what they are or whatever. I don't know.
Maybe the devil sent them to do bad things. You know, they are doing their job too. I mean, there's that. They are, they have little pointed ears and they're not for the blue devil. You know, that's the obvious way to go. But if we're playing against type.
Maybe they're supposed to do really bad things and then it ends up being little nuances that end up being noticed and immortalized somehow, like Tower of Pisa and famous statues where maybe the nose is gone or maybe the limbs are gone, as an example. And yeah. So they keep failing at their assignment to cause a ruckus in horrible ways, but really it's just these little things that we notice.
I kind of like that, because that can even lend to people liking it. Like, hey, somebody thought this was a great piece of art. They knocked the arms off. Hey, they're going to hate it now. Oh, it looks better. So they keep failing by trying to do, like, again, it doesn't apply to most of these examples. I'm specifically going off of the art. But, like,
right.
They fail at being bad because people keep liking it. If there's a couple examples there that are okay, again, some of these are terrible examples. World War One and all that is not okay, but it's a thought and an angle if we want to come up with some more, you know.
it's an interesting thing. I mean, it's like, what's the dynamic? Do they have, you know, do they have a mission? Who establishes the mission? Do they just establish the mission, or are they given a mission? What's their motivation?
I almost envision that they're given an assignment and their only goal is to either stay employed or get a promotion from whoever gives them.
I have another question for you guys based off of what Natalie just said that kind of sparked an idea, and this can totally go out the window as quickly as I say it. That mission from, you know, the boss, whoever the head honcho is, if it's like, I mean, I know you've kind of seen it before, but like an organized hell or something like that. You have the company, the Hellco, or whatever you want to call it, and you have the big boss, and he gives you your missions, and there's all the greats within the company, you know? Oh my God, Steve, he caused the extinction of the dinosaurs, and oh my God, Tom, he caused, you know, World War One. We want to be like these guys. We want the promotion to be on the wall. And then they do this stuff, and it's like, you know, there's our smaller, like they try to, again, I keep going back to the nose of the Sphinx or something. And meanwhile, somebody actively also caused the Great Castration, where they all have the fig leaves. So, you know, they keep getting one-upped by other demons in the corporation, and they can just never quite get there, but they're friendly to each other. I still like that camaraderie idea. They're not mean. They're just trying to be really good at their job.
I mean, Billy Bob, he actually sunk Atlantis.
Exactly. Wow, I want to be just like him.
Yeah, I mean, he was good.
Really?
And he did it on his lunch hour.
Exactly.
Billy Bob.
Maybe there's a Hall of Records.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, he did the Hall of Records while he was on vacation.
They gave him the best parking spot, and he doesn't even own a car.
And I knew him at Cal Arts.
There you go.
You know, you can throw that one in. I think that'd be funny, like as a chatter while they're trying to do a job, you know, that stuff can come up. But, you know, the babe, demonic babe or something. I don't know. We can come up with a name. He was great. He did Chernobyl or whatever.
Yeah, that's not really good. They try to be the best Blue Devils ever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they're always second rate, you know, never good.
Mm-hmm.
It opens with the explorer telling about the legend of the Blue Devils. Then it goes to them contemplating what they can do. What's the worst thing they can do? They'll think of something, and then maybe the guy will try to stop them. But every time someone comes around the corner, they disappear, and it looks like he's trying to cause trouble.
Yeah. He just keeps getting banned from countries. I don't think he can even fly anymore. He just has to go by boat.
They chip off the nose on the on the Sphinx, and they drop the hammer right in dude's hands. He's like, oh, shit, you know. They catch him.
Let's get him.
Oh, the cops are chasing him.
Yeah, so they could be intentionally trying to cause trouble, but then unintentionally causing trouble for him.
Every time he gets caught, right?
Yeah.
It's a guy that looks like him through history. It's like, it's always his forebearer. It's like,
Yeah. It's like a whole family lineage thing somehow.
Right. So, like, if the Hindenburg, it's his great-great-grandfather or something. Is like, you know, at the bottom of the thing, right? He's holding the, like, some lighter or something. It's like, wait a minute, it wasn't me. Stonehenge, right? He's a druid standing there with a stone tool or something. Like, I didn't. They all get pushed over. It's always his forebearer standing there through history. It's
even the caveman.
He messes up the bison, right? We turn around and it's him with the long hair, like Neanderthal version.
I feel bad for him, but that's definitely a good avenue.
Maybe at one point he actually gets a hold of one of the devils and like shakes him. What did you do that for? But then everybody else surrounding him, all they see is just air between his arms. It just looks like he's just shaking his fists.
Yeah, the lizard people. What the hell? They come up. That's so funny.
Don't know how we could really add this one, but maybe opening Pandora's box somehow.
Pandora's box. It's always good for a laugh. I like the idea of, oh, the babe.
It's an iconic name, yeah.
He was the man, you know.
No one can cause chaos like him.
Oh, yeah. I made one of them sort of a hothead and one of them's a bit.
Yeah, find some way to distinguish them.
Yeah, kind of the right. He could be Paulier.
Mm-hmm. How stupid is he? Like, is this even something where we could possibly give him a name that's not conventional? And I please don't use this, but like when they have characters called Fish or something stupid, like, could he even have a name that's just like, again, I don't have one yet, but Paulie and.
What's a good word for stupid that no one's used yet?
Dunce.
Doop.
Dope. Dunce.
Did you say do too?
Yeah.
Or putz.
Putz isn't bad.
Putzy is funny.
Dolt. D-O-L-T.
There's such a thing as dorb.
Don't stop messing with the Tower of Pisa. Get over here.
Polly and Putzy.
Which one's the Bronx and which one's the Midwest one again?
The angry Polly one is the Bronx.
Okay.
The guy on the right, I think, is Polly. It just seems sort of Italian-y, Jewish-y kind of. Angry guy.
Yeah, he's the more ambitious one.
Yeah. I just love the babe. They're always a little looking up and a little angry about the babe. He got all the kudos. Putting on my organizational hat now, you know, because we've got some personality and we've got some idea of where to go. So I think we should think about somewhat of an outline and have everybody to start doing some boarding out some ideas. Think about what's the funny thing to do. Like, do we want to have a scene in the Hindenburg? Where they're up there in the little control room and they're saying, yeah, really, the controls should be over here. No, it should have been over here. Paulie pushes Putzy, says, you know, no, you're wrong. And he pushes him on the control and then you cut to the outside and it goes, wah! Then something falls out the window, maybe a wrench or something falls down and there's a guy below and he totally the wrench. It's the guy that looks like, you know, are we going to have the schmuck that gets caught holding the bag each time? Or is he not in this anymore? I don't know, because we kind of like got away from him. And what is his name? Well, who is this guy? He's the schmuck, as far as I know.
I personally liked the little devils and the whole legend of the babe direction, but that's my preference.
He kind of got lost in the shuffle.
I mean, I don't mind ditching him, but I'm just wondering what kind of the opposing force is going to be for them then. Is it going to be kind of like how they're kind of trying to go up the ranks and stuff? Is it kind of like a person versus society kind of thing?
I thought it was more like that business promotion thing. Like they couldn't, you know, they're working within their own system, within their own hell group, whatever you want to call it. I mean, we didn't really establish it yet or at all. But it's kind of them just trying to raise the ranks within their own demonhood.
We don't have a structure.
I was going to suggest going along with the line with the whole kind of corporate organized hell thing that, that the two of them have, you know, they go to their boss to get their assignment and their boss is, you know, like a lady devil in a 80s business suit. And she's like, you know, and she's the one who's assigning them to do whatever. And, you know, as they go in to talk to her, you know, and they leave, then they'll like either see the babe or there'll be like a big painting on the wall of the babe. And like, you know, as their kind of shining example of, you know, this is what we want to aspire to. And
right.
You know, if we really want to get that promotion, we got to impress the boss lady and do a really good job today, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's kind of what I like.
So then she'll give them the assignment and then they'll go off and do whatever. And that's, you know, kind of, you know, that's sort of a structure that could, you know, theoretically be, you know, repeated in the future of, you know, episodes would start with, you know, you go to the boss and you get your assignment for that day.
You know what? I'm going to play devil's advocate for a moment. I'm not convinced that we want to see that person.
Yeah, I was going to say, you never see the boss.
I'm just thinking we don't want to. I feel like it's so conventional. I'm not sure we want to see that world and that we want to see the underworld and all that. I kind of want to, I feel like we just want to, maybe it's a phone call or something.
Yeah.
Or it's like we talk about it, but we never have to really see it.
Yeah.
To me, it's more fun to just have their, you know, little relationship and we get on with the caper. I don't know.
I think it is better like that sometimes because it just kind of works like that though.
I guess this is an important question since I, you know, was not there for the very beginning. Is this show meant to be like for, you know, the kids 6 to 11, or is this like Adult Swim or what?
We're not really worried about it being that. I think
I'm just, you know, wanting to know, like, you know, like you said before, avoiding religion and politics, like what things, you know, should we avoid or whatever, you know?
I think it's just, we're just making a good cartoon, and then we don't worry about so much that aspect of it. That'll come together, you know. I think we just make the best cartoon, and then, yeah, I mean, I think we stay out of religion and politics anyway, because I like timeless cartoons, personally.
Exactly.
I like cartoons that are good for anybody can enjoy them, and they have their own reasons, whatever. We should be looking at it from the point of view that it's character-driven. Cartoons get dated no matter what you do. You can't help it. You look at a cartoon and go, yeah, I know that was made somewhere between 1950 and 1956. You know, I know somehow it was made somewhere in there. So,
would it be worth exploring? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go ahead. I'm babbling on.
No, it's great. Would it be worth exploring, like, if we get away from showing the corporation side, and it is like a simple phone call with a fun voice, that whole babe concept, because we're going to get the idea that they aspire to be this. Would it be worth showing like a small set of scenes that are like daydreamy on their side, like where it shows like one or two little things that the babe did, and then they flash back to their reality like, if only, you know, so that way as an audience, we get the context, but you're never really diving into underground world.
I think that's funny. You just know that the babe's
a badass.
I think that's funny. Yeah, the babe doing something, or even a statue of the babe, you know, almost like Babe Ruth, but doing something terrible. Maybe he even looks like Babe Ruth. Yeah, but he's doing, you know, but he's like sinking the Titanic. How did he sink Atlantis? He's actually pulling the plug. Maybe it's like Atlantis had a plug and he's pulling the plug.
Maybe he just presses a button and it just makes the whole thing go down like an elevator.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, you know, it's, there's some right. It could be
another plug is more like interesting, or something involving like a toilet sound effect.
Yeah, I always think you know, babes with a bat. You know, I know there's a statue somewhere I've seen of the babe, you know, with the bat in his hand, you know, so maybe it's kind of like that, you know, it's pulling the thing out.
But if we're not going like with a detective, what's the opposing force preventing them from keeping their goal? What are they doing from the start when they've been given the mission to the end when they've completed or haven't achieved it? Like, what's like, are they getting tangled in the wires in the Hindenburg and they're trying to look for the thing and they're getting lost or something? Or maybe it could be them, like one of them doesn't want to do the mission this time and the other one really wants to and they're clashing against each other. But I feel like there needs to be something, because otherwise, what's preventing them from doing the mission? Like, what's the middle part of the story?
I was thinking about that, and maybe one is focused on doing the mission, and the other one gets distracted and causes mayhem elsewhere that ends up causing this big conflict later on. So maybe a little bit of not inner fighting per se, but bickering between the two characters, because one gets distracted and does this thing and the other gets frustrated with that one. But then it causes, you know, maybe the Tower of Pisa to lean over or the Sphinx to lose its nose, you know, any number of things.
Yeah, maybe they have different ideas on how to do things and somehow that always leads to that thing happening.
There was a show years ago I used to watch as a kid that was the time tunnel, and these two guys ended up, you know, just at that right moment in history, like right before something terrible happened, you know, and they always tried to, you know, prevent, you know, things like the Titanic from happening or whatever, you know, some terrible thing, you know, JFK or something. They were always just ending up just right before something terrible would happen. And, you know, could they stop it? You know, the whole idea was, well, can you guys stop it? Or, you know, or Quantum Leap or whatever, you know, there's always been shows like that where, you know, what if you could stop it from happening? You know, and of course they never could. they always screw up right before it could happen. But, you know, so now, you know, we've got a reason why these things always happen. You know, these two dopey devils make things happen, which is you know, a funny reason why things happen.
But while they're trying to do this, the things, the explorer tries to keep capturing them, but he's followed every turn unintentionally by them, and they're none the wiser. They don't even know he's after them.
Well, if they don't know he's around, Just trying to figure out his interaction. How does that work?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's only so much he can do without being noticed as a direct force against them.
Maybe some, like, they'll look into a bag to find out weapons to destroy something with, and they go, nah, and they keep hitting the guy in the head.
He gets blamed every time.
Maybe he gets caught with, like, an axe in his hand or next to, like, something, and he sees it's one of those not what it looks like things.
It's like right there. I feel like we all have it. It's just a matter of like putting it in the right place. Like this is one of those take a minute, think about it. Oh crap, I got it kind of things.
I'd like to assign everybody some section to play around with, to do some sketches. You know, like Brandy, play around with, I don't know, something you'd like. Say maybe it's something with the Sphinx or something, you know.
Right.
Or, yeah. You know, Richard, you know, do something with, name a section that you think you'd like to like board out a little section on.
Okay.
The Hindenburg. Who wants to do some exploration on the Hindenburg?
I have a few ideas that I can board.
Okay. I'm going to put Richard up by the Hindenburg.
Yeah. I have an idea for a gag for Library of Alexandria.
Okay. Is it too obtuse, though? I don't know. I mean, I'm not trying to put you down, Luke. I'm just
saying. Right. Well, then I'll take Stonehenge.
Yeah, Stonehenge is very visual, very people know.
Can I do Julius Caesar?
Okay, Julius Caesar.
I'll take the Tower of Pisa.
Okay, Tower of Pisa.
No, I'll take the Sphinx. I'll play with that.
Nobody wants to do the entire extinction of the dinosaurs.
That one would be fun. That would be fun. Are we kind of keeping the character sketches really loose because we don't quite know some of the directions yet? Or like how do you want to go about that as well?
I would say, you know, just try to get the essence of what's needed right now.
And then sure.
We'll tighten them up later. But let's just try to get down good gestures and good expression and that kind of thing.
Sounds good.
This was so much fun.
Awesome.
Fun.
All right. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay. See ya.
All right. Bye-bye.
Well, I hope you enjoyed the class. In the next session, you'll see how we altered some key ingredients that solidify the whole concept and really pull it together. But I don't want to spoil anything right now. You'll just have to wait and see the next video, so hurry back. Oh, by the way, if you like this video, please subscribe and hit the like button. And if you're interested, you can join up and take the class online with me. Just click the link below and go to my website for details at richaarons.com. Thanks.